is Crane Song from Delta Squid, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
Hey, this is Zettel, creator of Imba League and Husky Madness, and you are listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
This is Chan Man B of Wednesday Night Sprites and Climbing the Ladder, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
Yo, it's Tempo from IBD Gaming, and you are tuned in to my brother Synvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Nick Axavranish from Major League Gaming, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Boogie2988 here, and you're listening to my good friend Synvicta on SS Radio.
Live on Twitch TV and on the VODs here on YouTube.com, it's SS Radio! 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 And now, here's your host, Synvicta. Up, what is going on, ladies and gentlemen out there on the interwebs and internets? Welcome out to SS Radio number 110. Coming at you not live because I recorded this offline. Well, I recorded it online on my online software, but not on stream. And there's a couple reasons why that is going to be, and I'll explain that in a moment. But of course, today is going to be Sunday, February 1st, 2015. We are already in the month of February. Can you believe that? Isn't that crazy? There's only like 10 more months until Christmas. What's going on in the world, man? Is that I find out that when as the more you get older, or I should say the older that you get, the quicker time flies by. I mean, soon enough, like, we're going to all be like 60 and 70 and the internet's not even going to be a thing. At least I hope the internet is going to be a thing, but maybe not. I don't know. I don't know what the future holds, man. But what I do know is that I'm very excited to talk about tonight's SS Radio topics. One thing I will say tonight, I don't know what the run length is going to be, because we have a very, very important discussion to talk about here on SS Radio. Of course, if you've never seen or heard SS Radio, it is the monthly podcast that I do every single Sunday. It's the first Sunday of every month, I should say. It's a show I used to do bi-weekly. We used to do it on Tuesdays and Thursdays with my friend Sepercrod. And since then, the radio show has kind of transitioned into more of a monthly roundup for what's been going on in the last month and the upcoming month in regards to what I'm doing on both of my channels here on Twitch as well as on YouTube. And that's going to be the meat of tonight's topic, is talking about some changes that we're going to be going over in Twitch as well as just my thoughts on a very important subject that I've been kind of holding off until recently, where I've kind of alluded to this on the Twitch channel as well, but I am going to be hopping right into that. But before we get into that, of course, we have to show the topics. So this is how we do it here on SS Radio. I count it back down from 3, 2, 1, and then I show the topics. So 3, 2, 1, there we go. The topics tonight for SS Radio number 110. I'm going to be giving you my thoughts on the Founders Pack for Heroes of the Storm that Blizzard just recently announced and have made available. You can buy your way into the beta. I've been getting a lot of questions concerning my opinion on this, and I'll go ahead and give you my full disclosure about what I feel is right and maybe what is not right for the Founders Pack. Again, that'll be coming up top at number one. And then sticking with the Heroes of the Storm content, also going to be talking about the brand new show that I debuted this past Friday, entitled Forecasting Live, and I'll give you my kind of process on how I decided to evolve that into a live show. And turns out, find out, I don't actually have to do a live show anymore because we found a way to strip the team chat. But alas, I digress. We'll get to that in just a little bit. And then last but not least, for the third topic, going to be talking about the Twitch channel changes that I was alluding to earlier in the introduction here on Twitch, or on SS Radio, because it's going to be the third and fourth topics especially are going to be kind of melded together in what's probably going to be a half-hour discussion. I'm going to try to limit it as much as possible. And speaking of the fourth topic, money and new media, the struggles of being a smaller channel like mine, in comparatively to someone else who is not a smaller channel, and it's, I hope that it's going to not discourage you or any of my fans out there who've been asking about, you know, how do I get into new media? I want to do what you do, Synvicta, but how do you do it? Like, how do you afford stuff and that sort of thing? That is going to be the discussion. Hopefully, it's, I don't want to say it. Hopefully it's the last time I have to talk about it, because I think it should be an open discussion for everybody. But I've been recently trying to cut back on talking about money and new media, because every single time I do, it ends up turning into the same discussion over and over again, where at the very end of it, it's like, okay, well, you know, nothing's really going to change, that sort of thing. So I want to give the stripped down version and really dive into my mentality when I talk about money and new media. And finally, last but not least, of course, the biggest topic of all is just thank you to everyone here on YouTube and Twitch and all my fans for the years of support that some of you have shown, including the new fans like. And again, I'll be getting all that in topic number 5. But shall we begin? Right back up to the top, talking about the Founders Pack here for Heroes of the Storm. Blizzard recently just made that available for purchase. You can buy your way into the closed beta for $40. You get 2,500 gold. You get Thrall, You get Raynor, Diablo, and Tyrande, I believe, along with 2,500 gold. And you get a mount and some skins as well. It's a pretty good deal. Some people said, well, you know, Blizzard shouldn't be charging for this. Why are they charging? Because we can just get in the beta for free if we're streaming it enough, or if we follow someone, they give out keys, or whatever. You know, I like Blizzard's decision on this based from a business point of view, because they know that the game is going to be a hot ticket item. They have created a really strong demand. And they've also, and since they control the supply, I mean, Blizzard is the gatekeepers on who gets into the game and who doesn't. I mean, that's really the John Madden herpa derpa call there of the night so far. But when you go into it a little bit deeper, from a business perspective, it makes a lot of sense. Blizzard's saying, well, you can wait if you want to get into the Heroes of the Storm beta, or you can just give us $40 and we get you not only access, you can start your own YouTube channel if you want. You can, you know, have skins and stuff and stream it and get your career up and running if you wish to become a fledgling Heroes of the Storm content creator. I'm not really sure what to call them without sounding smug or being cocky or anything like that. But yeah, Blizzard's basically saying, give us $40. Here's the access. Here's a bunch of skins. Here's some heroes. Here's some gold to get you started. Have fun. Thanks for playing our game. It makes sense from a business decision. Now, from a fan's perspective, people have always been asking me, would you, Sinvicta, do you think it's a good deal? What would you do if you got offered this? And my answer is simple. I would not pay $40 to get into the beta. People have tried to equate that as buying into early access, but it's not really early access. Heroes of the Storm is a game that's been working on for a while, and I don't think the title of early access can really be applied to a game like Heroes of the Storm, given the fact that not only is an online MOBA going to be, not only is a MOBA going to be constantly changing and updating, it's a persistent world on top of that, but also because of the fact it's Blizzard. We're not talking about an indie studio here. We are talking about a AAA premium games development company. I mean, they've got, you know, they publish everything, they develop it, it's everything. I really don't like the term early access being used for Heroes of the Storm, because it doesn't make any sense. And again, this is a game that I personally play tested. I don't even remember when the first Heroes of the Storm video was put out. It was when it was the original Team Low Expectations, which was myself, Husky, TB, Krendor, and originally it was Chris Chan Man V, and then it evolved to Jesse, of course. I think it's been a year, maybe almost a year. I'm not really sure. I was in the technical alpha since day one, so it feels like a game I've been playing forever. Admittedly, a game that I haven't always been into up until very recently, where I've definitely taken a more serious approach to it. Now that Blizzard has said there's going to be no more account wipes, you can get to keep the XP and the skins and stuff that you earn, especially your gold as well. And obviously, going into topic number 2, before we get into that, I made it into it's become the premier content on my YouTube channel as well as Twitch, and that's awesome. But people, it's hard to ask me a question, would you spend $40 to get into the Founders Pack? And personally, I would say no. I would not do that because there's so many ways for you to get keys out there on the internet right now. I mean, Blizzard's giving them away directly. You have streamers doing it all the time. There's contests being run over on various Heroes of the Storm related websites. There's a lot of, I mean, there's a lot of people that want it. Don't get me wrong. You still have to get pretty darn lucky to earn one of the, or to win one of those beta keys. But you get what I'm saying. Like, I feel like there's enough avenues and means for you to get into the beta without having to spend $40. But at least if you do decide to spend $40, this is a direct way to do that. You can support Blizzard, not that they really need financial support, which is not a bad thing. I'm just saying, you know, it's, if you don't give Blizzard $40, they're going to make it, I promise. But, it, you know, it shows support for the game. And like I said, what they've done is ingeniously intertwined supply and demand all in the same product and made it to a point where it's a smart business decision. But if you ask me on the streets, Invicta, would you pay $40 to get into the game? I would say no. I'm just going to wait to see if, A, I get randomly selected for the beta test because they're going to be ramping up the amount of people that they accept or that they invite into the beta test. And, B, because I don't want to spend $40 on it. I mean, it's kind of like, yeah, I would love to play it, but I'm not going to pay to play it sort of thing. You know, there's plenty of other great Blizzard games or even free MOBAs out there that I could play that don't require me to spend any money. So, yeah. Final call on it. Business decision. Makes sense. Personal decision. Would I actually buy into it? I would say no. Just wait for the beta. But I realize that a lot of my fans out there are really itching to get into the beta, even though they may not have been lucky enough to get selected. And you don't want to be patient, then I'd say that it's a worthy investment. Look, people are saying, "Oh, $40 is a ripoff for what's going to hopefully be a pay-to-play game, or a free-to-play game." And I would argue that it's actually a pretty good value. When you think about it, $40 is way cheaper than you're going to spend on any AAA title unless the publishers are absolutely insane or they're trying to do some sort of PR gimmicks, you know, stunt sort of thing. $40 gets you three heroes, the skins, in-game gold that you can buy other heroes with, or it can get you started on the master skin grind, you know, if you want to do that sort of thing. I said $40 is pretty cheap. You're going to spend more than that on another game that you can't play for the rest of time ever, you know, that you can't record, you can't upload, that sort of thing. If you bought them separately, it's going to be way more expensive to buy all the heroes, and not to mention you're not going to get any gold for that separately than just spending $40. Plus, you get guaranteed safe beta access. You get it from a trusted source, which of course is going to be Blizzard, and then you can just start doing whatever you want, or just playing it for free. I mean, no, really not for free, but you just playing it freely is what I tried to say. And not everyone who wants to play Heroes of the Storm is going to want to try to turn it to a YouTube thing, and that's great because I don't think that. I think that it's a little unless you already have some pre-existing experience with new media and stuff, hinging your entire hopes and dreams off of one game and that you had to buy your way into, I would say is, it's not a bad idea, but it's a dangerous idea. It's kind of a risky one, not dangerous. It's risky. But again, I'll talk about that as we get to topic number four. But on our way to topic number two here on SS Radio number 110. That is the wrong scene there. There we go. Good Lord, man. I swear I'm out of practice. 1 month down, and I've already forgotten how to use OBS and SS Radio and all those scenes. Going on to topic number two, talking about forecasting live. Something I talked about earlier in topic number one. Yes, I've been taking the Heroes of the Storm content much more seriously now. And it's even funny. I have had the astute fan or two on YouTube notice the fact that I've stopped putting the little rage face, LOL emoticon face on the thumbnails. And one of them, I don't remember who said it, but they said that it's clear that you can actually pinpoint when Sinvicta stopped treating the Solo Q silliness series like a joke and actually, you know, started treating it seriously, because I stopped putting the rage faces on there. And I wasn't sure if anyone was going to pick up on that. But I've got some of the greatest fans ever. I mean, I know that everyone on YouTube or everyone on Twitch says, "Well, we've got the greatest fans ever. We have the greatest fans ever." But I am really, really proud of the Mosh Pit and the community that we've built around the YouTube content as well, and by some extension to the Twitch channel as well. I do really feel very fortunate to have such a positive and supportive community that, you know, to set the foundation of the larger scale community of what we're going to be transitioning into, hopefully in the future, when or if that happens, who knows, but that's beside the point. Forecasting live, I have not seen a higher turnout as far as numbers are concerned for a brand new show, even after the week that I had last week, and I was not able to debut it when I wanted to, which is going to be last Friday because of the whole power situation. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, just go scroll through my old tweets. You'll see exactly what I'm talking about. But yeah, we had a great turnout for Forecasting Live. A lot of excitement revolving around the new show. It's going to be happening every single Friday, starting at 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern Time, and 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. It's basically the old Friday Night Fan Fights time slot on my channel, and is the only live show that I will be doing outside of the Midweek Mosh Pit, which is a StarCraft II arcade show that I host along with Trayscent and Zovia from Blizzard themselves. So Forecasting Live is how I decided to do that was that we were having the issue early on in the forecasting series, and this is something that I didn't expect to happen, and I was really crushed that I found once I found out that there was no way to mute the team chat from Here's the Storm replays. Because at first I wanted to take the standard Sinvicta, well, you know, whatever, people are still going to watch it. It's if people get mad because the team chat betrays the winner of the match and ruins all the suspense, well, they're just going to have to get over it until Blizzard patches it out. Because I did bring this up with Blizzard directly a while ago, and they said that it's been moving up the development chain, but it's not a top priority, which I don't blame them for. But as forecasting the standalone series here on YouTube progressed more and more, it was very clear that people were losing enjoyment very rapidly of the series because of the fact that 100% of the time so far, the team chat that you see displayed on the screen is going to be from the team that won the match. So once people already know who won, there's really no reason to watch it. I mean, all the suspense is going to feel sandbagged, and it's just not going to be fun to watch. And I eventually begrudgingly decided that, you know, that's probably going to be it for the series because I can't control. I'm not going to ask people to send me in just losing replays every now and then just to spice it up a little bit. You know, because what that does is that alienates people who really try hard to win. They send in this amazing comeback victory, and then I say, well, I can't take it because it's not a losing game. Like, that doesn't make any sense, and I was never going to intend. I was never intending on doing something like that. But what I was originally going to do was just simply suspend the series until Blizzard patched in a way to mute the team chat. And then more recently, I did have a fan email me. He showed me that and this is something that everyone's been doing lately, which I made into a prerequisite for submitting replays for forecasting eventually, was that the old MPQ trick where you can stream from StarCraft II replays, where you can strip down the team chat and the pings in StarCraft II and submit that and re-render it as a brand new replay file, because replays are not video. They're basically sprite keyframes, if you want to think of them that way, in the simplest of terms, that are basically keyframed with every second of or every millisecond of every active time period where the game is going from start to finish. It's a very simple process, and what the step-by-step guide provides you is how to remove the team chat and strip the pings. Sometimes stripping the pings work. I've seen other times where it doesn't work. That's fine. The pings don't matter. As long as we can't see team chat, that's all I cared about. So, and again, if you are that fan, you know who you are. The initials were MM. That's all I will say. Thank you very much indeed. But during that weird transitionary period where I felt that I was going to have to suspend forecasting as a series until the team chat thing was fixed, or at least patched out, I got the idea to maybe turn it into a live show, because at least that way I would not have to worry about seeing team chat, because observers cannot see team chat, period. Otherwise, that undermines the integrity of the live game. If the other team's stream sniping, blah, 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 I don't need to go into that topic. So I came up with it. I decided that I wanted to release it last week. Didn't happen because the power stuff. I had to do it this Friday, and it was amazing. We had over 150 people tuning in at once, which for me is a lot. That's a lot of viewers. That might not be a lot of viewer for you out there, and I'm sorry that I can't be Mr. Big Bombtastic like you are. But for little old Sinvicta, hey, that's great, man. That is awesome. Over anything 100 people over is a that's a good night for me. I purposely was not running any commercials during the show. I always run for my live shows, historically speaking, I always run commercials at the end of the show, which most people don't stick around to watch, and that's fine. I don't blame them for it. But you know, it was a good time. My voice was shredded. I don't know if you can tell, but my voice is still kind of raspy from it. Forecasting is a pain for me to do just because of how hype that I naturally do things. Like when I naturally cast, there's something different with me when it comes to my casting style from RTS, from StarCraft 2, versus doing stuff like League of Legends, Dota, or even now going into Heroes of the Storm. I don't know why. It's a switch that I can't turn off, but my voice raises like 2 octaves, and I feel like I'm consistently yelling the entire time, even though I may not be volume-wise yelling. That's the strain. Imagine yelling as loud as you can for an extended period, all while trying to control a camera, trying to do some sort of analytical insight, you know, and on top of that, trying to make sure there's no technical issues and making it entertaining as well. That's a lot to ask of one person. And I'm not saying that I can't, that I'm not up for it, because it's what I've been doing, you know, since I've started here on YouTube, pretty much outside of the Word of Law episodes. But it is a lot, and it's the hardest show for me to do, which is the reason why you've not seen that many standalone episodes from Forecasting on the channel recently. I originally was going to try to do one replay every day and upload it and release it daily here on YouTube. I quickly found out, especially after doing the live show, that my limitations are only going to be my main limitation is going to be my voice. I cannot afford to destroy my vocal cords because of what I do for a job. But I am going to try to do, I'd say, probably 2 Forecasting standalone series here on YouTube a week, maybe 3, maybe 4. But what's nice about Forecasting Live is that I can chop those games up, and this is by design. This is completely 100% deliberate on my part. Is that I can chop up the games from Forecasting Live and upload those on different days here on YouTube. That way, for people who didn't feel like or did not even care about coming out to watch the Twitch channel, you still get your Forecasting games. And for those of you who don't want to wait for it to get released on YouTube, then you can just go to my Twitch channel and find it on the VODs there. So it helps me in a lot of ways to get all the Forecasting episodes done out of the way like that, or not all of them, but most of them. But also providing everyone a live show, you get to take place in the show, or you get to participate in the show, and it's a lot of fun. Everyone really enjoyed it. They loved the new overlay, which I did work really hard on. Even though it looks like a simple overlay, hey, trust me, that overlay was tough to do. The transparency, not really the transparency, but getting the angles down, like getting it just right in Photoshop, and then carving out like the UI. It was pretty involved. So, bottom line, I do want to thank everyone for the continued hype and excitement surrounding Forecasting as a series, along with Forecasting Live, and I'm very, very much looking forward to continuing that series as we progress on the Twitch channel. And speaking of the Twitch channel, as we move on to topic number 3, talking about some upcoming changes that you are going to start seeing more and more often on my Twitch channel. For those of you who are members of the Mosh Pit, which is the name of my community that I give to the subscribers and non-subscribers alike on my Twitch channel, twitch.tv/Sinvicta, we're going to start seeing some upcoming changes that are worse changes that I was against, but I've realized that it's inevitable. So a popular trend on Twitch right now, for those of you here on YouTube who don't go to Twitch streamers, Twitch channels, or your favorite streamer, etc., a popular trend is to do stuff like, you know, keeping track of today's current subs, you know, encouraging a subscriber quest, donation goals. You know, there's the big flashy pop-ups that say, you know, whatever, you know, so-and-so donated $6.66, and they text to speech, like all, like the note that the donor can actually leave for the streamer, and everyone usually puts like expletives and racist stuff, and it's funny, blah, blah, blah. Well, I refuse to conform to that kind of trend up until very recently, just because of the fact that I don't feel comfortable doing that. I do not think that you need to make a big deal and clutter up the screen when you stream to be successful on Twitch. And again, I'm not passing judgment on anyone who does that. A lot of my friends who are Twitch streamers do all that. I mean, they do everything. They say they've got like daily sub goals, and they wear a funny hat or donation goals, and they get to choose, you know, what color dress the streamer wears. I don't know. I've seen all of it on Twitch. It's just not Sinvicta. All right, I don't even like taking donations, but I begrudgingly got over that with myself. But as time progressed, especially at the start of this year, I was hit with some really gnarly bills that I straight up could not afford to pay, but they were bills that I had to get paid, and it became shockingly clear to me that I need to do more as a content producer to market myself and to basically, in layman's terms, just make more money. And I know that is a loaded sentence to say, especially when you're talking about people who watch all your content online. A lot of people think that, you know, for new media, as soon as you go live, as long as you have even a core following of, like, say, 30 people, oh, he's getting donations, oh, he's making so much money, that sort of thing. That's not really how it happens. So what led me to realize the inevitability of having to conform to some of the Twitch culture, some of the Twitch trends, I guess I would say, was the fact that I realized that I simply cannot afford to do this anymore. And it's starting to get scary for me because I don't want to stop doing new media at all. But the reality of the situation is that I need to do more as a Twitch streamer, as a YouTuber, to not only promote myself, but market myself and see what I can do to bring in a little bit more help, generate a little bit more support from a revenue side of things, if I truly want to continue this as my chosen career. So what that is going to lead to is that I still am not going to do the whole... It's really hard because I don't want to sound like a hypocrite. And the only reason why I'm even making this into a thing is because I've made it a thing in the past to refuse to do stuff like this. And a lot of people have enjoyed coming to my channel because of the fact that I don't make a big deal out of donations. I don't make a big deal about subscriber goals and that sort of thing. Yes, I do have the pop-ups because I do feel that people should get a little bit of recognition for going that extra step beyond the normal fan or the normal viewer. And they actually want to give you some of their hard-earned money to support you because they directly... They get excitement, they get joy out of watching your content, and so they want to give a little bit back. And I do believe that people do deserve that sort of recognition. But in the past, there has been a limit for me. Now, and for those of you who watched my... who've watched my more recent Here's the Storm streams, I do now have a donation tracker, a little bit of a ticker that shows the recent donors, and I have a subscriber ticker showing the more recent subs on there. The Twitch trends... As much as I don't want to conform to them, it's how it is. People, you cannot deny the fact that if people get a chance to get their name seen on your stream, knowing that whatever their name is going to be seen by hundreds, if not thousands, of people, they are going to be more inclined to donate. They want to subscribe. Maybe they don't care about you. Maybe they don't give they don't give two dams about you or your content. But they just want to get their name up there because vanity is what all humans possess in some shape or form. And the reality is streamers who do that will earn more money. They earn more money. They get more subs. That's just how it goes. And again, I've always constantly bucked the idea of doing something like that. But again, up until very recently, it was in the third week or maybe second week of January where I got hit with two really awful bills that just had to pay that wiped out basically all the finances that I had. I was like, okay, well, it comes down to this. How much do I want to fight? How much am I willing to sacrifice to make this new media thing my career? And the answer is I would sacrifice anything to make new media my career. Obviously with well within reason. I'm not going to like murder two newborn sheep and feed them to a rabbit or something because that's the dance that I need to do. It's not anything as dark as that, but you understand what I'm saying. I'm willing to get over myself, and I have to learn how to get over myself and my prejudices over not doing certain trends. Just because they're trendy doesn't mean they're wrong. Too long didn't read Twitch channels. I'm going to start incorporating a little bit more advertising for the subscribers and for the donors. I'm still against the whole donation quest thing. So the subscriber goal, the daily subscriber goal stuff, may be something that I'm going to tinker with. But for those of you here who watch my content exclusively on YouTube, this should not affect you. This is something I haven't talked about, but for those of you who only exclusively watch my YouTube content, you may or may not have noticed that I did indeed get approved for a tip jar. And this only goes to partnered channels here on YouTube for now anyway, because I'm still testing it. But if you go to my main channel page, the youtube.com/Invicta316, on the right-hand corner, right above where it says My Pals, and I list Husky's channels under there along with Ro and my other friends, above there it says Support This Channel. If you would like to contribute to support myself directly, you could do that through YouTube, and it goes straight to, I honestly don't know the financial side of things. I'm pretty sure they take it from credit card or PayPal. It's Google. But that is a direct way to support me financially. Again, 100% completely optional. And I stress that all of my content will never, never be pay-per-view. My VODs are always going to be free. My YouTube channel, obviously, is always going to be free. But I am going to start actively promoting more ways to support myself, because this is truly what I want to do for a career. And there's no backup plan. This is what I have strived for the past 2 years, and what I'm going to continue to strive for. And the last thing I will say about it before we go into the real big topic, which is topic number 4, is that I will continue to do new media for as long as I financially can. But when I cannot do it anymore, then it is unfortunately it. I'm not a gray area person. It's white or black for me. I'm either all in or all out. And this is something I talked about on the last SS Radio, so I'm not going to rehash it. If you want to understand my reasoning and logic for that statement, then please view SS Radio number 109. I talk about it towards the end of the show when I'm talking about expectations for the year 2015. Moving on to topic number 4 here on SS Radio number 110. This is the topic that I have been avoiding to really diving into up until now, but I figured with all the Twitch channels changes, with talking about the new live show and other ways, trying to generate some sort of promotion for myself, now is a great time. It's the perfect time for me to really get into the meat of the discussion when we're talking about money and new media. I'm very, very lucky to be in the position that I am. Some people may not see it that way. Some people may see, you know, a nerd who lives at home, and he can barely, you know, it's pathetic, because he can't go out and buy the things that he has outside of gas and food for his dog. That's about it. Other people, some out there, would say they would love to be in the position that Sinvicta's in. You know, it's a small but very fast growing community, fast growing channel. I can't even get five subs on my YouTube channel. I'm not going to be partnered anytime soon. You know, and some people would feel fortunate to be in my position. I personally am always going to be the glasses half full type person. I am extremely lucky to have the friends that I do, and again, all credit will forever. Forever in a day, forever in 2 days, will go to Husky, who, without Husky, again, none of this happens. Husky is the reason why I am here. He's the reason why I have the friends that I do. And he is the, all that comes back to Husky. And he knows that, which, again, we're like brothers. I mean, he is my brother. We've been good friends for a while now, and I could never thank him enough for that. And it's those opportunities that Husky gave me which really drives me to make the most out of this career, out of new media. I feel like if I don't make this into a thing, if I don't make this into a sustaining career, then I have thrown away an opportunity that was gifted to me by whatever benevolent force you believe in, or maybe non-benevolent force you believe in, from Husky. I'm just throwing it away, that people would kill. People would kill to be able to be Husky's friend, to be able to talk to him, to be able to, you know, to chit-chat with Crendor about the UFC fight, or laugh at Jesse because he's getting mad at Hear the Storm, or just even talk to him, you know. People would kill for that. And I am not going to waste this opportunity. It's a once-in-a-lifetime experience and a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. But there's struggles. There is definite struggles along the way. The only reason why I'm able to do what I do right now, and this is something that I've talked about, but I'll say it one final time, is because I worked a real job as an IT specialist down here in Houston. I managed an office building where it was a repair shop where it was basically all IT work, fix computers, do networking, that sort of thing. I did that for 2 years. I didn't make very good money, especially when comparatively speaking to my bartending career, I didn't need to work more than 3 days a week. Okay, I was making a lot of money, and when you're young and you have what seems like endless money, you don't really worry about saving. I mean, I know I didn't. Like, you know, if I had a girlfriend, whatever she wanted, she gets. Outside of like something serious, like a house or a car or something, hey, the girlfriend wants a new iPhone. Hey, there you go, baby. Just don't. If you cheat on me with it, I'm gonna come back and take it back, sort of thing. You know, if I felt like I needed the new Xbox game, I'm gonna go out and buy it. If I felt like I needed to buy, like, you know, a new really awesome three-piece suit for business meetings, I'm gonna go buy it. Like, that's how it was for me. I felt like buying a 46-inch TV cash just because I had the money. I was like, yeah, you know what? I've never had a flat screen. I'm gonna go out and buy it. That's the kind of money. I wasn't rich by any means, but for being a bartender in a college town, I was doing fairly well. I mean, 3 days a week, I went to the bar, I worked, our DJ'd or manager bounced, and then the rest of the week, I was spending working out or playing video games. That was it for me. That was my routine out of college. But after working the real job at the IT place for 2 years and meeting Husky, during that time is when I met Husky for the first time, started doing work for him. You know, we got a friendship going, you know, and I've helped him out over the years through various stuff, which no one will ever know about outside of me and Husky. But I realized that because I was still doing the World of Warcraft PvP videos, I realized that with Husky's help, you know, and of course, this is something that he offered to me. I didn't ask him for any promotion or anything like that. This was his way of paying me back for the stuff that I was helping him out with. He was like, yeah, you know, if you decide to start taking a serious approach to new media, you know, maybe we can start working together on just some little things. Because back then, that was his heyday when Husky was the biggest of all of StarCraft content creators. And he still technically kind of is. I decided that, you know what, that's what I want to do. I was still doing SS Radio, even though I wasn't really doing the YouTube thing very seriously. I was doing SS Radio on Twitch. I had maybe 15 viewers at a time, if that. You know, I'd say 5 or 6 of those people were real-life friends who just wanted to listen to my voice. Oh, Sinvicta, you know, Brad's on the internet, sort of thing. And I realized that that's what I truly enjoy. There's two things that I truly enjoy in this life. It's making music and also creating entertainment, which I guess music is a form of entertainment. It can be a form of expression too, but I truly enjoy writing music and I truly enjoy creating entertainment for people out of my own mind. Whether it be pictures, whether it be funny videos or awesome PvP videos or me talking on a microphone to an invisible audience that I could not see at the time. All that to me is what I truly do. If I did not enjoy doing what I do, I would just simply stop. That's how I've always been. And that includes to jobs as well. If I stop enjoying a job, I leave. I mean, I don't like set the place on fire and take a dump on my boss's, you know, desk or anything, but I realize that it's not my passion. This is what my passion is, and this is the only job that I've had that I've consistently been like, I cannot wait to go live on stream. I cannot wait to record YouTube videos today, because it's a brand new day. I get to update people on what's going on in my life on top of providing them with hopefully entertaining content, and I haven't had that many complaints. So, but the trade-off is that you don't make any money. You make zero money from new media 99.999% of the time. There is a very, very, very small percentage of people who enter into new media without having any experience, without having any other famous friends or personalities on their side to promote them, that are able to make 1 cent off of the content. They could create for to the end of time. They could spend 13, 14, 15 hours a day making the most gorgeously edited or the most action-packed videos that they can. And without some sort of help, without some sort of promotion, it's not going to be seen. And furthermore, you're not going to make any money off of that. And I'm not saying this to discourage a lot of fans, because I do have a lot of fans, mostly the younger fans, who say, Sinvicta, you know, I really love your content. You know, you're one of the few people who have started really, literally from the ground and worked your way up. I mean, I have ground up the following that I do, that I have for the past 2 years from nothing. And people, you know, I do get younger fans who recognize that. They say, I want to do what you do. How do I get started? And the best thing that I can say is that what you need to start out new media is have a backup plan and have the right mentality. If you go into new media with the mentality that you're just going to make a ton of money, you're going to move out to LA, you're going to, you know, live in a huge mansion, it's not going to work. I'm sorry. That, again, is a statement I've said before. I'm going to attempt to not rehash old stuff. But again, I've had a lot of new fans subscribe since the last SS Radio. You cannot go into new media wishing or thinking that you're going to be making money. You have to do it because you want to do it. It's your passion. It's what you have fun with. And people will, they'll pick up on when you're having fun. They'll also pick up when you're having not fun. See any losing at Soul Key silliness there for that reference. But even as someone who, I'm not established, I'm known, I'd say, I would admit that I think that I'm known well enough to go to, you know, to other Heroes of the Storm streamers to say, you know, say hello, everyone. Or at least because of the work I've done with Krendor, Jesse, and Husky, to be like, oh yeah, that's Invicta. I know him from somewhere. Like, that's how kind of where I am right now. I do get recognized a lot in game, and that's really cool. I don't make a big deal out of it. I just, you know, if someone says, I love your content or whatever, you know, I thank them because I do appreciate it. It holds a lot of sentiment to me for people to say stuff like that. Even though it may not seem like a big deal to you, it means a lot to me. Because this is truly my passion. I feel very special when I do YouTube and that sort of thing. But the reality of the situation is that it's a difficult struggle when it comes to financial terms. If, you know, I've never lived paycheck to paycheck, and as Twitch goes, you get paid every 45 days. As YouTube goes, you get paid every 31 days, depending on processing. And it's not a lot of money. It is not. I've said this before, and I'll say it again, because I believe in transparency and I believe in honesty. Between my Twitch check and my YouTube check, every 45 days, I make less than $500. Me. I'm pulling in right now over 200,000 monthly views on my YouTube channel. I don't really know how they keep track of views or monthly views on Twitch, but I know that my audience has been growing very slowly but very steadily into what the Mosh Pit is now, which is a very core group of about 80 people or so that mostly show up to any stream that I do. And yes, that is including subscriber, the money I receive from subscribers on Twitch. I'm not joking. It is $500, it's less than $500 every 45 days. And I cannot go into specific numbers because I'm, again, contractually bound, but I'm allowed to give a ballpark estimate, and it is less than $500. Now, for those of you who are in college or in school, you're in high school or even in middle school, that might not seem like a bad thing. Like, well, $500, that's like half a grand, man. You could go out and you could buy a mini video game. You can go spend it on whatever kind of Quiznos you want. You know, it sounds like a lot of money, but it's not. It is not. When you talk about you're receiving less than $1,000 every 45 days to pay for bills, to pay for food, to pay for gas, to pay for anything else that might come along the way, when you have all of a sudden a surprise $400 bill drop out of nowhere that you have to pay, otherwise you get in a lot of trouble, that's like, well, okay, my bank account is just at zero. And the reality of the situation is you need to do everything that you can. If you get to the level where you want to make this as your career, where you are making a little bit of money, not a substantial amount, but it's a little bit, you learn how to stretch a dollar, you learn the value of a dollar, and you learn what you can live without. I've learned that I can live without going out to bars. I've learned that I can live without drinking. I used to be a big drinker. It was never an alcoholism issue for me. I like going out and partying. I like going out to the bars, the clubs, that sort of thing, kicking back, watching Sunday football with friends, drinking beer. I used to drink a lot. I was never addicted to it. I always felt that I could stop drinking whenever I wanted to. And I honestly don't remember the last time I drank heavily. It's been years. But I discovered that, you know what, I'm okay with staying at home all day. I'm okay with not having to go anywhere but the gym. And the reason that is because I simply can't afford to do any of that. I'm okay with not playing the newest and latest game that came out on Steam the other day because I simply can't afford it. And it's a startling transition when I think about my life personally from what it used to be when I was a bartender to now. And you realize that every little bit helps. And that, which is why I say at the end of my commercial breaks, or at the beginning of my commercial breaks, you know, for those of you who stick around to watch the ads, I do appreciate it. It does support myself, albeit very little, but every little bit counts. It really does. The 90 cents or so that I make on 3 hours worth of streamings, and those, you know, having 3 minute blocks of commercials, it's 90 cents, but you talk about 90 cents every 45 days. Well, let's just call it a dollar every 45 days. Hey, that's an extra $45. That's a gas. That's almost two gases of tank right there, guys. Two tanks of gas, at the current price. Like that's, I'm talking about economical living. Like that's how I am right now. And I never thought that I'd be that way, but when you're pursuing something that you truly love and that you're truly passionate about, these are sacrifices, and I'm willing to make even more sacrifices than that because I do not want to squander the opportunity that was given to me by Husky. And I feel that that's what really drives me to want to turn this into a career. And I'm somewhat doing it, arguably not doing it very well. But I'm still a small channel. Look, I'm not stupid. I'm not naive. There are many other channels out there, even with 40, 50,000 subscribers, that are bigger. They pull in bigger subscriber numbers than me. But one thing I will say is that I know people, and of course I'm not going to name names, but I know people who have 40,000, who have 50,000, even 60,000 subscribers on YouTube that don't get as many views on their content daily as I do. And the reason why that is, I feel anyway, this is speculation, this is experienced speculation, but the reason why I feel that is because the fact that they probably were promoting in some sort of spammy form, or trading like a sub for a sub type thing, like that trend was in YouTube about 5 to 10 years ago. Their numbers are very inflated. And if you were to look at my I don't remember the name of the website, but you can look at a channel's growth for the past month or however long you want to make the timeline, and you can see from people who are around my size, 14,000-15,000 subscribers on YouTube, the mosh pit's destroying them. It's not even close for as far as our monthly views are concerned. And I feel very special about that. And I'm not saying this to be cocky. I'm not saying that, you know, this, like, I'm just better than these people. But I do flaunt it a little bit because it's something that I've worked very hard for. And I'm going to continue to do that. You're going to be hard pressed to find a YouTube channel that puts out 2 to 3, sometimes even 4 videos like today, per day. That like my channel does, and the reason why I do that is because I'm working on this nonstop. I got into a pretty big argument with the family a little while ago. They're saying, you know, you know you're not making any money. Like, you can't do this forever. You're going to starve to death. You know, we see, you know, you're working 10, 12, 15 hours a day, and you've got less than $500 every 45 days to show for it. That's not a job. You know, you're not getting paid enough to do what you do. And that's the old world talking to the new world. And I came up with a quote that I've never heard anyone else say before. I'd like to think that I'm the first person to rationalize it in this way. But my rebuttal to that statement of the whole, you know, you put way too much work in for not enough money. My rebuttal to that was, this is the only industry that I know of where the amount of work that you put into it does not accurately reflect the amount of money that you get. That is the most true statement I could ever have thought of when I'm talking about new media. You can put 25 hours a day into your YouTube channel. The bottom line is that if no one watches it, you're not going to get anything for it. It's just that simple. I can put, you know, I my heavy recording days are Mondays and Tuesdays on top of doing the Twitch stuff. I can, theoretically, I could say that I work 80-hour weeks or more if you want to go that far. And this is what I have to show for it. Not a whole lot of money. I can't really pay for anything outside of basic necessities, that sort of thing. I couldn't even afford to go to PAX South because I can't afford the hotel reservation. That's the sacrifice. That's the yang of the yin or the yin of the yang. I don't know how it goes. I don't know that stuff. But you see what I'm talking about. And making money in new media is very difficult. Outside of direct donations, unless you are pulling in millions of views a month, you are not turning this into a career. And that might seem cold-hearted, but hey, I'm right there with you. I'm lumped into that category. I think that to get in new media and to make money, you have to be A, lucky. Above all else, you have to be lucky in some form or fashion of either knowing someone who's already established in the business, or you got lucky because you made a funny video on YouTube that went viral and then it was picked up by like Tosh.0 or something like that. And then B, secondly, you have to be good at what you do. And I think that people sometimes have that reversed. I've seen a lot of very talented, even fans of mine, who put on, you know, they have great presentation on their content. They've got a good, solid technical background. They know how to balance audio. They know how to keep it from sounding like crap. They know how to video edit, or they know how to graphics design, you know, make sweet overlays. I've seen a lot of my fans do that, but no one watches the content because no one knows who they are. And that's how cutthroat it is. I mean, again, I am not speaking from someone who is established. I am not established. I think that I'm known. I'm known enough to where someone probably can say, yeah, I've heard of you. You know, what was so cool to me about BlizzCon was meeting, like, I met when I was hanging out with Duncan and Shin from the Yogscast. We were just chit chatting at the Twitch party. And I introduced myself to Duncan. I said, hey, I'm Brad. You know, it's I'm also known as Invicta. He's like, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. He's like, I've seen some of your Heroes of the Storm videos. I like it. Like, that was cool to me. You know, he's not going to know who I am, and he's not going to remember who I was. But that was cool. And Shin also said he watched some of the Heroes of the Storm, just randomly browsing it one day, looking for bills. And I thought that was cool. Like, that's what I mean when I feel like I'm known, but I'm not well-known. I'm not a celebrity status by any means. But I am speaking from someone who did start from zero, and someone who, without being extraordinarily lucky to know the people that I do, would not have been able to do this. I would have probably just been either sick to my stomach, working 9 to 6 every day for 6 days a week at the IT place, or back to bartending and being sick constantly because I'm allergic to cigarette smoke. And just, like, you know, this is what I want to do. And I think that when reality really crashes on people who try to do this and fail, they say, well, I don't know how you can do this. Or how could you possibly think that you could make any sort of sustainable, livable income off of something that is so difficult? And the answer is, I don't have to think that I can. I know that I can. It's just a matter of, do I think I can do it long enough and sacrifice enough to get to that point? I'm confident when I say that I know that I'm going to be able to turn this into a living. When, I don't know. I've never been big on schedules. I've never been big on timelines. Because I think that you can't rush yourself whenever you're talking about important life-changing decisions like this. I've sacrificed a lot doing new media. I rarely talk to any of my real-life friends anymore, including my best friend. I do play video games still, which is great, you know, but I feel like I have new friends. I have thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of new friends on YouTube and on Twitch as well. And I've always been someone who's enjoyed being alone. You know, I have had relationships, of course, probably more than I probably should have. None of that happens. None of that happens anymore, and I'm fine with that. Again, I'm willing to sacrifice anything and everything that I can to make this into a career, because that's what I truly want to do. Some people will say, well, you know, Sinvicta's probably going to end up selling out and that sort of thing. And the answer to that is no. I'm not planning on selling out. Trust me, I've received many. You'd be surprised with how many offers I've received from companies, some video game related, some not, where companies try to get me to hawk their products or hawk their website or their MCN or anything like that in my videos. And I've simply just said no. A couple of them were moderately sized amounts of money that would make me think a little bit twice about, you know, is this really a smart idea to say no? But the reality is, I feel that I need to earn it, not on my own, because you can't do it on your own. You cannot do new media on your own. You need help. You need your husky. You need your friends that you could collaborate with. You can't do it alone. And what I've realized after 2 years of doing this is that's truly the case. I've tried to do it on my own. You can't do it. Just because you're putting all this work into it, if you're doing it alone and you're the only one watching your videos, hey, guess what? Congrats, you did it alone, but you're not eating anymore, sort of thing. And I don't feel like I'm doing it alone anymore. With the amount of fans that I get, with the new subs that I get, with the new viewers that I get on Twitch, you know, I'm not in this alone. And with that kind of support, I know it's no longer an if, it's a when I'm going to turn this into my eventual career, because it's truly what I want to do. Working with video games, working hand in hand with Blizzard has been a complete honor and a dream, and I look forward to continue on doing that. But above all else, I hope that I can continue to be as entertaining as possible and do this for as long as I can. And again, when I'm no longer financially able to do it, that's when I just simply stop. And which is why I'm willing to sacrifice self-integrity. I'm willing to sacrifice and get over myself, the prejudices against doing the Twitch streaming stuff, or not the Twitch streaming, but the trends on Twitch, and say, you know what? If this is what you truly want to do, you're going to have to get over yourself, make sacrifices. You're going to have to do some stuff that you're probably not going to want to do. I'm not talking about back alley of a Hollywood video place kind of stuff, but I'm talking about the sort of things where I would traditionally have felt very uncomfortable doing, because I feel like it's panhandling. I feel like you're basically pandering to the masses, sort of thing, and conforming to this ideal that you have to whore yourself out to make money in new media. And I have to get over those sort of prejudices and stereotypes, because that's truly how you make money in new media. That's truly how you do it. You can be good at your job in new media, but if nobody watches, no one's going to know. It's the whole, you know, if a tree falls in the forest but no one's there to hear it, doesn't make a sound. The answer is no. It does not make a sound, because no one's going to know that. No one's going to know that that tree fell. No one's going to know that you uploaded the video, and no one is certainly going to pay you for that video. Last but not least, because I do want to end it on a more positive note, I want to say thank you to everyone who has stuck with me since the Lauder days. Thank you to everyone who just subbed as of today, watching the brand new Solo Cucilius that I released earlier with the Thrall game. I got a little salty in that video, but I try to contain it as much as possible. And, you know, it's that kind of stuff where I really do truly feel special and lucky to have the mosh pit around me. I feel very honored, and I don't use the term blessed, because I think it's a loaded adjective, but I do feel extremely fortunate to have attracted so many awesome people to the YouTube channel, so many awesome people to the Twitch channel, and it's truly... From me to you, I say thank you again for supporting all the content. I know that a lot of people are still here from the Lauder, from the Word of Law days when I played WoW, and I was Lauder. And I also know there's people who only subscribe to the channel just for the SS Radio show, and I do appreciate those. Everyone out there, I do appreciate it, and I hope that I can continue to build on what I've already established here on my channel, on both channels, and turn this into a reality, which is financial independence. Supporting my family, if I ever get a family, sort of thing. I mean, I'm not planning making a family anytime soon. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, I'm getting up there in age. Eventually, I'm going to have to start maybe deciding. Well, should there be a little Sinvicta or a little Sinvictette running around? Probably. I know that the my mom especially has been touting the old, you know, I want to be a grandmother horn. So, you know, it's I do it with a smile on my face because it truly that is truly where I would like to get to it at a certain point. But without your help, without your support, I can't do it. And I just want to say thank you to everyone who does support the content out there. I promise to you that I'm pledging to you that I will do a better job of making this channel even bigger and better than you could possibly imagine. And, you know, if you're willing to stick with me and come on down on the ride, on the train with me, whatever you want to call it, Space Jam, LOL, 420, Yellow Swag City, then hey, you know what? Go ahead. I can't thank you enough for that. So that's going to do it, everyone. Thank you very much for listening to the Ramble and Rant. Again, the SS Radio Show is going to be happening the first Sunday of every single month here on YouTube as well as on Twitch. I normally record these live, but with the Super Bowl going on, I straight up just didn't want to because I want to watch the Super Bowl. So again, thank you very much, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the show, and I'll see you next time for SS Radio number 111 coming up in the month of March. Until then, so long, everybody.